Okay. Now, as disciples, our righteousness, meaning our behavior and our speech and our attitudes, will exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees in that we are inwardly transformed people, those to whom God has given a new heart. So our righteousness flows from inside out. Our righteousness is not external and formalistic, but captures the spirit as well as the letter of the law. If it doesn't, then we're not true disciples and will not enter the kingdom of heaven. And that's what he means when he says, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees. And I pointed out in what sense he means that. Now, beginning in chapter 5, verse 21, Jesus sets out some particulars of this higher righteousness, this deeper righteousness of transformed people, this deeper righteousness of kingdom participants. And he deals with the sin of anger in chapter 5, verses 21 to 26. And he highlights the seriousness of the sin by illustrating the urgency that's necessary to repair the damage that is done by sinful anger. And he addresses the sin of lusting in chapter 5, verse 27 through 30. And he explains that it, like all sin, must be dealt with radically, because the consequence of impenitent sin, of making an idol of that sin and putting it above the Lord, is the loss of the whole person in hell. You see, it's a completely different thing. Struggling with sin in penitence is what we all do. That is a completely different thing, you see, than living with the sin, than embracing the sin and making peace with it. Now, when we ended last week, we just started looking at Jesus' words on divorce in Matthew chapter 5, verse 31 and 32. That's where I want to pick back up. I'll read the text again. I'll repeat some of what I said, and then we'll carry on from there. But he says in chapter 5, verse 31 and 32, it was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. That's from Deuteronomy 24. The Mo's are back. Hey. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the, I don't know why these slides are doing this, but this is interesting, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. See, they'd heard this. They had heard that one divorcing his wife had to give her a certificate of divorce, and that's a reference to the teaching again in Deuteronomy chapter 24, 1 to 4. And they inferred from Deuteronomy 24, verse 1, they inferred from that text that a man could divorce his wife for something indecent by giving her a certificate of divorce. And they debated the permissible grounds for divorce. And I mentioned that last week, and you're familiar with that. You had this one school, Rabbi Shammai. He maintained that something indecent, well, that was something grossly indecent, something like unchastity or infidelity. But you had Rabbi Hillel, another school. Hillel, he extended the meaning beyond sin to all kinds of offenses. I mean, if I read you the list of things, it's really, we'd see it as comical. But all kinds of offenses, even to cooking a meal improperly and that kind of thing. And it wound up becoming that a husband could divorce his wife under that school of thought at a whim, for absolutely any reason. Now, I mentioned that Jewish wives were not permitted to divorce their husbands. The legal process was something that went from the husband, he divorced the wife. But now the wife could force the divorce. She could do things that would require this person to divorce her, not just sexual immorality. They had all kinds of rules about that. But in the Gentile world, the wife could be the divorcing party. Okay, I say that because I think it'll help clarify something in a bit. Now, the point of chapter 5, verse 32, if you could see the rest of 32, the point of 5:32 is that God's law is not primarily about the formalities of divorce, about giving the certificate. See, that's not the focal point of it. It's the necessity of the certificate. That's not the major thrust of it. The major thrust of it is the sanctity of marriage. That's the real point and thrust. See, divorce is a grave, serious matter in the eyes of God. The formality of a certificate of divorce and the prohibition of remarrying the divorced wife after she had another husband, that discouraged hasty divorces. It wasn't like when you gave somebody a certificate, it was okay, this is it, we're done, and she marries somebody else, well, you don't get her back. That's Deuteronomy 24. And so the real thrust of it is to discourage, hey, say, okay, you're out, you're in, you're out, you're in. No, when you went ahead and said, okay, you're out, she marries somebody else, she's gone. And so it was designed to discourage hasty divorces. So the law really points. It points to the original purpose of marriage as a relationship of permanence. A point that Jesus makes in Matthew chapter 19, verses 3 through 9. This is the thrust, this is the direction where the law is pointing. As God said through the prophet Malachi. In Malachi chapter 2, verse 16, I hate divorce. Now, there's an issue there about translation, but almost certainly says, I hate divorce. And that reveals, you see, something of God's heart. Well, as Jesus authoritatively interprets the law, as he mediates the law to us as the law's fulfiller, the only permissible basis for divorce is sexual immorality, which of course includes adultery. Now, divorce, it always involves evil. There's always something evil involved when there is a divorce. It always has that character and quality to it. But just as Moses permitted divorce because their hearts were hard, you remember Jesus says that in Matthew chapter 19, verse 8? So Jesus permits divorce among those with new but not yet fully transformed hearts. But he permits it only for sexual sin, for some kind of significant sexual activity with a person other than the spouse. So he permits divorce even among those with new but not yet fully transformed hearts, but he permits it only for sexual immorality. Now, the traditional and dominant understanding, I'm going to have to get the whole text up here, so maybe I have it in a later slide. Let me park on this one. Okay, for some reason, when I put the slide in later, it shows up, but here. See, the traditional and the dominant understanding of 532, it says, see where he says, but I say to you, everyone who divorces his wife except on the ground of sexual makes her commit adultery. Now, the traditional and dominant understanding of that verse is that a man who divorces his wife for a reason other than sexual immorality, he makes her commit adultery in that he leaves her in a position where it is presumed she will be driven out of economic necessity to remarry, and that remarriage is in some sense an act of adultery. So the man who divorces his wife for a reason other than sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery. And the traditional dominant understanding of that is, how does he do that? Because she will be left in a position where it is presumed out of economic necessity that she will remarry, and her act of remarrying is an act of adultery. I say it is in some sense an act of adultery. Well, why do I say it is in some sense an act of adultery? I say that because I don't believe it is literal adultery. I know many people believe it's literal adultery. So just don't throw rocks at me. I'm teaching you how I understand it. You take it, chew on it, weigh it, and if you think it's wrong, then you'll have to live your own understanding. Okay, but I do not think it's literal adultery, and I do not believe it's literal adultery because I do not believe the divorced spouses are still married, which they would have to be for literal adultery to exist. I don't believe the divorced spouses are still married, because I'm convinced from 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 and 11, that a divorce, even contrary to God's will, is still effective to dissolve a marriage. Paul here in 7:10, he says that a marriage is effectively dissolved even by a divorce contrary to God, to the Lord's will. He says here that it renders them unmarried. Okay, he says, now to the married I command, not I but the Lord, the wife, I command the wife not to separate from her husband. But if she does, the command not to do it, but if she does, what's the consequence if she wrongfully divorces? Well, the result is the parties are rendered unmarried. Okay, you also see this in Matthew 19:6 and Mark 10:9, where Jesus commands the people not to separate what God has joined together. He's referring to a marital union. Do not separate what God has joined together. Well, he obviously, to me, is not commanding them. He's not telling them not to dissolve marriages that he permits them to dissolve. I mean, why would he say that? You can't dissolve marriages that I permit you to dissolve. That would be contradictory. So he's clearly telling them not to dissolve marriages contrary to his permission. Okay? And that says then the implication is that they have the power and ability to do that. If they could not do it, if they could not dissolve a marriage contrary to God's will, if it's some kind of metaphysical bond that is indissoluble by people, then why tell them not to do it? They can't do it anyway. Okay, so those two texts tell me that the parties are not still married. Even a divorce that is even contrary to the Lord's will is still effective to dissolve a marriage. Okay, well, if sinful divorces, if they're effective in dissolving a marriage and separating what God has joined together, then how can Jesus say a divorced woman commits adultery by remarrying? You're sitting there going, what's he talking about? How can he say that? You see, what can he be meaning? If she's not still married to the first husband, how can she possibly commit adultery? That's why I said in some sense she commits adultery. Because I think it's figurative adultery. It is figurative adultery that she commits in the act of remarriage. Jesus, in my view, is referring to the violation of a right of exclusive commitment that survives the dissolution of the marriage. Now, as I put together, there are many texts that you have to look at and think about. And as I put together a host of relevant texts, including this one, Matthew 5, 31 and 32, Matthew 19, 3 to 9, Mark 10, 2 to 12, Luke 16, 18, Romans 7, 1 to 3, 1 Corinthians 7, 10 to 16, 1 Corinthians 7, 27 and 28, 1 Corinthians 7, 39, and several texts from the Old Testament. As I put these things together the best I'm able and try to put the puzzle pieces together, it seems to me that marriage creates a right of exclusive commitment that can survive the dissolution of the marriage. It's only a divorce for sexual immorality. Only that divorce extinguishes this right of exclusive commitment prior to a remarriage, and then only for the guilty party. In other words, the guilty party, the sexually immoral party in the marriage, that person no longer has a right of exclusive commitment from his or her former spouse. In that case, the innocent party, the party that did not commit sexual immorality, is free to remarry. But the guilty party, the one who committed sexual immorality, commits adultery, quote, by the act of remarriage. In other words, violates that innocent party's continuing or ongoing right of exclusive commitment. Now, where there's a divorce for some reason other than sexual immorality, okay, a guy just comes in and says, hey, I'm tired of you, never loved you, you're out. where there's a divorce for some reason other than sexual immorality, the right of exclusive commitment that survives the dissolution of the marriage, it remains mutual. So both parties in that case commit, quote, adultery by remarriage. It's not literal adultery because they're not still married. It's not literal adultery, but it is still a violation of a residual, maritally created right, and thus it's analogous to adultery. See, there's a reason why he calls it adultery, and I think it is this residual, maritally created right, so it is analogous to adultery. That's how it looks to me. Okay, so that they do wrong. Now, back to 532. If the divorce is for a reason other than sexual immorality, the wrongfully divorcing husband, he is a cause. He is a cause of the wife's presumed wrongful remarriage. See, having put her wrongfully in these dire economic circumstances and situation, he therefore bears additional culpability. He not only is wrong in divorcing her for a reason other than sexual immorality, he bears the additional culpability of her then wrongfully remarrying. He is a cause of her wrongfully remarrying and committing that figurative adultery in that act of remarriage. So he has that additional culpability. He is a cause of her doing that. See, now if he divorces her for sexual immorality, well, he doesn't share any blame for her subsequent adultery upon remarriage. That's all on her. That's what I think he's talking about. And that is not at all novel. I think that's what he's talking about here when he says that he makes her commit adultery that way. Now, Jesus says in the last part of verse 32 that whoever marries a woman who has been divorced by her husband. Okay? A woman who has been. You have to understand the way this is working. This is only the man. He's the divorcing one. He says, whoever marries a woman who has been divorced by her husband. See, whether for sexual immorality or for some other reason. Whoever does that, that person thereby commits, quote, adultery. Well, what do you mean? Well, he violates the ongoing obligation of exclusive commitment that the woman owed to her first husband who divorced her. He becomes a party to that breach. I was trying to figure out if you look at here, husband, wife, I've got marriage bond, ongoing obligation of exclusive commitment. This is the way I see it, okay? So we have a divorce, and we have this residual maritally created right, and if she's sexually immoral, he no longer owes that to her. She continues to owe that. If it's for some reason other than sexual immorality, then it remains mutual, this ongoing right of exclusive commitment, so that this residual maritally created right to violate it by remarrying is figurative adultery. That's why I think he calls it that. Okay, I don't think the parties are still married. I don't think it's literal adultery. But Jesus is addressing the case you see here of a woman, he's not addressing that, where a woman divorced her husband. That is contemplated in Mark chapter 10, verse 12. He's talking about the husband who divorces his wife, and he's here speaking only of the case where the man divorced his wife, either permissibly in the case of sexual immorality, or impermissibly in all other cases. Now, whether the divorce was permissible, sexual immorality, or impermissible, the divorced wife continues to owe that duty. That's what I was telling you. Either way, it's mutual. If he divorces her for sexual immorality, he doesn't owe a continuing duty. She still does. Either way, she has that. Now, not if she divorced him for sexual immorality, but that's not contemplated here. That's in Mark. Okay? He's only talking about the husband who winds up divorcing. Okay? So the divorcing husband owes the same duty. If he divorces for a reason other than sexual immorality, the duty remains mutual. Either one would commit adultery on remarriage. Okay? Divorce on that ground, as I say, if it's for sexual immorality, it extinguishes his duty, that ongoing right of exclusive commitment. Now, let me say something. If this interpretation that I'm saying to you is correct, and this is just a variation of the traditional view, it is a variation of the traditional dominant view that accounts for my understanding that the parties are not still actually married. Okay, that's the only twist. There are people who say, yes, but they're still married. That raises all kinds of things, and I can't square it with what I see in 1 Corinthians 7 and those other texts. So that's the variation, but it's basically, it is the traditional understanding, okay, with that variation. Now, if that interpretation that I'm proposing to you is correct, it means, for example, that a faithful Christian woman whose husband marries her, takes her virginity, enjoys her for a while, and then kicks her to the curb, well then, she is barred from remarrying, though she's done nothing wrong and is the victim of her husband's betrayal and treachery. Now, even here, issues arise. This thing's like all of these veins that run off there. There'd be questions about, well, what if he remarried? Okay, I can't address all of the questions like that. I do have two papers on my site, theoutlet.us. One is called, I think, Some Thoughts on Divorce and Remarriage, and the other one's called More Thoughts on Divorce and Remarriage. So you can go look at those, okay? But see, I think, this idea, I want you to see that if what I'm saying to you is correct, that is the outcome of that. You see, that here's this man marries this woman, this Christian man marries this Christian woman, takes her virginity, enjoys her for a month, and then kicks her to the curb. And then the result is that she is barred from remarrying. Okay, she's barred from remarrying even though she did absolutely nothing wrong. Let's stipulate she was the perfect wife. Did nothing wrong. And she's simply a victim of her husband's treachery, you see. Now, if that's the Lord's will, as most are convinced, and I lean that way, if that's the Lord's will, then so be it. But the seeming harshness and unfairness of that result, it strikes some people as being inconsistent with the character of God. And so they wonder, are we missing something? When we have an understanding that puts God in that light, shouldn't we be thinking, are we missing something? John Noland is a New Testament scholar. John Noland, he says in his commentary on Matthew, the normal understanding of 532b, which would be what I gave you with my little twist on it, okay, but it's basically just a variation of that. He says, the normal understanding of 532b runs the danger of leaving the woman involved a double victim. She's been divorced by a husband who may well have rejected her at his own whim, as per verse 31, and is now to be barred from any new relationship because she bears the stigma of the divorcee. So see, he's grappling with this idea of, is that something that I think is consistent with the nature and character of God? Now, Noland has written he's written a number of things, but he's written major commentaries on the Greek text of both Matthew and Luke. And Noland proposes that Matthew 5:32 be translated this way. And I won't bore you with all of the, the little Greek details about why he thinks this is the way to go on this. But he says his translation that he proposes is, but I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, causes her, not to commit adultery, but causes her to have adultery committed against her by the husband's presumed remarriage. You see? And this gets in because this is a passive. And it raises these questions. Well, yes, it's a passive, but a passive in this type of context is typically for the woman used actively. But he's saying, what if not? What if here it ought to be a true passive? Okay. Cause her to commit adultery against her. And whoever marries a woman who not has been divorced, but who has gained a divorce, here, taking the passive and understanding it as a middle, the forms are exactly the same. Okay, so commits adultery. Well, see, this changes everything, you see. In his view, then, if this is a correct translation, Well, then in this case, see, Matthew 5:32 and Luke 16:18 for that matter, well, then they address only, neither of those two texts addresses the freedom to remarry of the innocent wife or spouse who was wrongly divorced. Neither of them addressed the situation I was posing to you where I said, okay, the guy marries her, takes her virginity, enjoys her for a month, and kicks her to the curb. Neither of them are talking about whether she can remarry. Both of them, see, are focused solely on the improper, the wrong acting party. Jesus says only, if you take Nolan's translation, Jesus says only that a man who wrongly divorces his wife commits adultery against her by his presumed remarriage, and a man who marries a woman who gained, who engineered, who provoked, who forced a divorce. Well, then that guy who does that shares in that breach, you see. So in both cases, he's focused on the active party who's driving the divorce. You see, somebody can gain a divorce, even though the Jewish wife had no right to do it. She could make the husband divorce her by doing things that required him to divorce her. There were all kinds of regulations they had. Well, if she did this, then you needed to divorce her. So she could be the driving force behind that. And you see, in this case, it would be what? It would be somebody who's got his eye on somebody else, another chickie, and he divorces this woman and goes and marries her. In the other case, it's a woman and a man who kind of got their eye on each other. She engineers the divorce and goes and marries him. And he said, nope, none of that's happening. You see, that's how he's looking at it in that way. You see, the woman who engineered the impermissible divorce and remarried, she would then be, do you see, she would be the Jewish equivalent of the Gentile woman who impermissibly divorced her husband. Right? I mean, she's the one who's actually engineering it. And when you look in Mark, you see the parallel then. So what his translation does, he makes Matthew 5 as a parallel to what you see here. Mark 10, 11, 12 says, and he said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. Okay, Nolan's translation of 5:32 causes her to have adultery committed against her. You see, it parallels that. You go back over here. And if she divorces her husband, we're now in a Gentile context where the wife had the opportunity to do that, and marries another, the implicit that she does it for some reason other than sexual immorality, and marries another, she commits adultery. Over here, a woman who has gained, whoever marries a woman who's gained a divorce commits adultery. All right, so that's Nolan's argument and his understanding and his take on that. Now, his proposal has a number of advantages to it, but it also has some difficulties. Okay, it has some difficulties which may explain why Nolan's view hasn't attracted much scholarly attention. I mean, I've seen some people, William Loder has said, well, yes, this is possible. Robert Gagnon looks at, yes, this is a possible translation. Well, you'd think so. I mean, the guy, Nolan certainly knows Greek. But whether it's correct, there are some issues, there are some difficulties that have to be overcome with it. But I think Nolan's view is interesting, and I think Nolan's view is possible. Okay? That's what I say. I think it's interesting, and I think it's possible. And that's just so that's it. Now, there are a number of other complexities that plague the matter of divorce and remarriage. Okay, there are a lot of little veins and things like that in it that plague it. And how the church is to respond, that's a separate question, right? That you first have this universe of things that are difficult issues and all of these permutations, like somebody with a blue eye under a full moon and all this kind of stuff. So you have all of these permutations that come up that plague and make these things complex just on the question of divorce and remarriage. But then you also have complexities on the question of how is the church to respond to those who violate the Lord's will regarding divorce and remarriage. Again, I can just cite you to the papers on my website, theoutlet.us. You can look and see there more details about this. But clearly, okay, complexities aside, clearly it is the Lord's intention. You see, it is His will that kingdom participants stay married. Right? Kingdom participants are to stay married. You can't miss that. That is His will. And the culture breached the church's walls decades ago with its cavalier attitude about the sanctity and permanence of marriage. See, leading us to think, well, you know, divorce isn't that big of a deal. To wink at divorce and to treat it as a private, personal matter, you know, that's just between them and I don't want to get involved and all that kind of thing. And this is the world that has breached the church's walls in that regard long ago, so it's not shocking that the enemy is now trying to make acceptable in the church things like abortion and homosexual conduct. He is invigorated by our timidity and our capitulation. You see, we have to labor to offer our marriages to the Lord and to stop rationalizing and tolerating our sin in this area. I know it's personal. I know marriages can be deep and difficult and all that kind of thing. But we are disciples of Christ. We're disciples of Christ, so we offer our marriages to Him. I know it's tough to swallow your pride and go ask for forgiveness and to confess this and do. I know that. But as disciples, this is what we are called to do. It is shameful for the church to be treating marriages like the world. I mean, it's just crazy. Okay? We have to understand the sanctity and permanence of marriage. 5:33 to 37. He says, "Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn.' But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is city of the great King. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let what you say simply be yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil." You see, an oath is an appeal to God to substantiate the truthfulness of a statement or a commitment to a promise. I'm calling on God, I'm appealing to God to substantiate the truth of what I'm saying or the commitment that I have made by way of a promise. And the question of what qualified, you see, as an appeal to God. Okay, yes, an oath is an appeal to God to substantiate this. Well, what is an appeal to God? What qualifies as an appeal to God so that this then constitutes a binding oath? This was complicated by the fact that it was considered blasphemous to utter Yahweh's name. So you can't simply say, "I'm doing it, I'm appealing to Yahweh." So you had to create indirect ways of appealing to God. All right, so what happened? Then the Jews wound up developing complex distinctions and regulations for when an appeal was sufficiently related to God's name to be considered a real oath and thus something that was binding. So this is what they did. They're working out details and all these things of what qualifies as a sufficiently connected appeal, sufficiently connected to God's name, to be an appeal to God, so as to be an oath, so as to be binding. And they had a lot of rules. For example, in Matthew 23:16-22, swearing by Jerusalem, that wasn't binding. Swearing toward Jerusalem was. All right, you see, this get pretty tricky. You see, so they wound up doing, and they created those kinds of things. Now, in 5:33, Jesus just gives a summary statement of several Old Testament passages in which prohibit false oaths and broken vows. So he just gives kind of a summary statement of a number of Old Testament texts that do that, that prohibit false oaths and broken vows. And then he highlights the absurdity of the current distinctions in oaths that were being made. He highlights that absurdity by listing some second-class oaths that were considered non-binding for lack of an adequate connection to the name of God, and explaining that all of these things are inseparably linked with God. What are you talking about? They're all inseparably linked with God. He even controls our heads. So all of these little rules that they've said, that, you know, this is not quite adequately enough connected to God to constitute an appeal to God, not closely enough associated to his name. He said, what are you talking about? He said, God is in control of all these things. See, the Old Testament requirement of keeping one's oath, of not swearing falsely, that points to the fundamental importance of truthfulness. That's its direction. That's where it's pointing. And that requirement, it finds its fulfillment. That requirement, that pointing to the importance of truthfulness, it finds its fulfillment in a truthfulness that is so consistent that there's no place for an oath. Right? That requirement, as mediated to us by the law's fulfiller, as mediated to us and brought to us by the Messiah, by the Lord Jesus, that law is that we are to be completely consistent in our truthfulness. See, since every word of theirs, every word of a disciple is to be honest and binding, there's no place for a disciple to offer sworn speech as distinctively trustworthy. Do you see? I mean, if I'm sitting here talking to you and saying things to you, and I'm telling you something, but I sit here and say, but I didn't swear. You see, but I didn't swear. You see? Do you see? If I'm going to say, no. When I swear, well, then it's distinctively trustworthy and you can take it to the bank. When I'm just talking, you take your chances. You see? Do you see what that's about? What's going on? See, to do that, to offer sworn speech as being distinctively trustworthy, that's an indictment against your own integrity. It's an indictment, which is why he says that buttressing one's oath or buttressing one's speech with oaths, that's why he says it comes from evil. It comes from evil. See, it is a reflection. It is born of an untrustworthy character that must do that. That is not how we're to be. Luke Timothy Johnson, he says in his commentary on James, if speech is meant to be a primary symbol of the self, if it is from the heart's overflow that the tongue is meant to speak, then the invocation of a special realm, whether heaven or earth, or power, the name of the Lord, to buttress one's own speech becomes paradoxically an admission that one's own speech is untrustworthy without such warrant. The more towering the oath, the more impressive the power invoked to support my own statement, the more suspect my innate truthfulness appears. Like if I'm over here going, oh, cross my heart on my mother's grave and all this stuff. Well, the greater I do that, the more I do that, the more I'm saying, if I don't do that, you got no hope of trusting me. That's the idea. You see, about how we're to be, Charles Quarles in his book on the Sermon on the Mount, he says, Jesus' command, don't take an oath at all, serves to undermine the legal loopholes in the Jewish system of oath-taking and requires consistent truthfulness that does not require oaths at all. Jesus' disciples are to be characterized by such integrity that an oath is not necessary to make their words credible. This is how we are to be as people. I don't care if you're talking to somebody you're selling something to. I don't care if you're talking to some other lawyer you're negotiating with. We have to be truthful people. Okay, there's no. Well, this is just white lying to people. You and I as disciples are to be truthful. When we say something, it's the truth. Okay? No lying. As far as we understand, right? I understand people can make errors. But we cannot lie. And this is another thing. Hey, you know, lying, come on. Everybody lies. You know, come on, you gotta lie. You see people say that. But that is not how we are to be as kingdom participants. This is something we are called to, a different thing. The Jewish historian Josephus, he reports that the sect of Jews known as the Essenes, they shared this view. Josephus wrote, he said, every statement of theirs, the Essenes, is surer than an oath And with them, swearing is avoided, for they think it worse than perjury. For they say that he who is not trustworthy, except when he appeals to God, is already under condemnation. Now the Essenes, they were around, that's the Qumran community. See, so this isn't something that's just completely unknown and out of left field. Okay, but quite inconsistently, the Essenes, they required an extreme oath for admission to their group. Okay, they could say what Josephus said, but then they wound up inconsistently. If you wanted to become an Essene, well, then you had to take this towering oath. I mean, like, you know, whatever, entrails can come out and all this kind of stuff. You know, I don't know what the oath was, but it was huge. So they were quite inconsistent on that. Now, this prohibition is probably limited to voluntary oaths. In an official oath, see, an oath that responsible authorities require. The one swearing isn't offering his testimony as more reliable. He's simply complying with somebody else's requirement for trustworthiness. And Jesus was placed under an oath. He didn't say the oath, but he was put under an oath, and he responded in Matthew 26, 63 to 64. Tell us. You know, and he responded. So I think this deals with voluntary oaths. Obviously, there are religious groups that disagree with that. And I'm certain there are individuals that disagree with that. But that's how that seems to me. Now, if Paul's witness for me, you know where Paul calls on God? Like in 2 Corinthians 1:23 and Galatians 1:20. If that witness formula, that's what it seems to be. He seems to be appealing to God to buttress what he's saying. Now, if Paul's witness formula, if it qualifies as an oath, it may be that love requires voluntary oaths to be given when circumstances make those oaths important for benefiting other people. You see, this appears to be what's in play with the oath of God that's mentioned in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 17. God did that on an oath. So there's something about taking an oath in some context that seems to affect this. You know, there's a difference. I try to illustrate it. There's a difference in my swearing to you that my elixir is an antidote to a snake bite, so you'll buy it from me. There's a difference between that and my swearing to you that my elixir is an antidote to a snake bite, so you'll take it before you die. See, those two things to me are distinct. And it may be, you see, that when love requires the oath to benefit somebody, that then maybe. So that would justify if Paul's appeals are, in fact, do they qualify as oaths? Maybe that's what's at play there. But anyway, what's clear to me is this notion that, listen, we are to be truthful people. As disciples of the Lord Jesus, we are to be truthful people. So the Old Testament accepted oath-taking. But it pointed, you see, it pointed to the higher ethic that is now expressed by the Lord Jesus. And his ethic, this higher calling, is that we are to be so consistently truthful that oaths are irrelevant. It's like everything I say is under oath. What need of an oath? And I tell the kids that. In fact, the grandkids, you know, they go back, you swear, I swear, I swear, I swear. I said, you ought to be stopping it. You ought to be somebody who tells the truth. You see, because that's an indictment against your character. If you can't be believed unless you say that, you ought to be consistently truthful. And I heard that bell. Thanks for coming.